song was used almost like an anthem for African Americans who were just fighting for a chance to get civil rights. Cook never got to bear witness the hope his song gave to the people all across the world. But through God and this song, inspiration was created and still calls.
Oh. together as your people.
Yes, Father.
To just praise you.
Yes,
to worship you because of who you are.
Yes.
And so, God, I pray right now that you would just speak to us through your word.
Yes, God.
And show us, each and every one of us, what you would have for us to see, to learn more and more about you, and to experience you even more fully. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Well, good morning, Lighthouse.
Good morning.
It is a privilege to be here. A lot of times I'm sitting like right over there, about halfway down the aisle. That seems to be my place, so I thought I'd try something different. This morning to sit over there. You see it from different points of view, and you see all angles in which God can bless. I'm so appreciative of Pastor Dale, who I appreciate as a mentor in ministry, a friend from way back. We don't put numbers on it because they don't date us both, but she's older, just for the record. But I do have gray hair, so, you know, I'm not young at all by any means. But Lighthouse is a special place. I've watched you from a distance in Southeast Michigan. I've come and participated in joint gatherings when there's been opportunities, when you first got into this building, all the different things that have gone on. I've appreciated this congregation and kind of as a side, call it my church home now that I'm not associated at Farmington Hills at the present time, and in between looking to see where God's going to send me. So this is where I hang out when I'm not filling in for another pastor around Michigan. And I'm privileged to be here and let Pastor Dale, who worked all night, not necessarily have to try to be awake and stand up here to preach, but hopefully she'll stay awake while I am. But I'm going to start us off by just standing as we read our first scripture. And I'm going to read a number of scriptures or reference a number of scriptures, but I at least want you to stand up, stretch your legs, and be awake for at least the first few minutes. As we read the first scripture in Ephesians 3:20, and I'm going to read it from the NIV. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. All right?
Yeah.
Immeasurably more.
Hallelujah.
You may be seated.
Yes.
Now, how many of you have been up late at night and you've been watching TV and one of those commercials come on?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, they're portraying the greatest product imaginable, the greatest thing since sliced bread. I can't tell you how many problems in life it's going to solve. And at the end of that commercial, there's this line that just, they all use it. They say, wait, there's more.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wait, you just said this was the greatest thing. How can there possibly be more?
There's more.
And so that's the title of the message this morning.
Yes, yes.
There's more.
Yes, it is.
There's more in so many different ways, and we're going to look at that this morning. Now, I know Pastor Dale has been in this series, and for the messages I missed, I went back on YouTube and was listening to him, because I was like, am I going in the place that she's already gone, or not? Well, she was talking about all these Old Testament characters. I'm like, wait, I was going to talk about one, and she got all the way around it, and she didn't really go after it, so I'm like, okay, God, you carved out this space. So we're going to talk about one of the greatest leaders in Israel's history.
All right.
You may have heard of him.
Yeah.
He goes by the name of Moses.
Yeah.
And so there's three ways that we're going to look at how we are positioned for more based on the example of Moses.
All right.
So the first way we're positioned for more is our potential for God. Okay, well, let's talk about Moses. And a lot of you know different parts of the story, but I want to refresh all our memories together just a little bit about his background. In Exodus 2, and you can go home and read that as a homework assignment if you so choose, but just in Exodus 2, big long chapter, a lot of different things things going on. But Moses was a Jewish person. Mm-hmm. He was born into captivity in Egypt. So all the people were oppressed. In fact, oppressed to the point where they were killing the male babies.
Yep. Yep.
And so Moses' mother wanted to protect her son. And so she took care of him for a little while, but knew she couldn't keep hiding him and putting him in a basket and putting him in the river Nile. Now, I have been in that part of the world a little bit, and I don't think protection is putting your baby in the river Nile with all the things that are in that river.
Yeah.
But it was the difference between possible life and known death. So she protected her baby as best she could, put him in the river Nile. Now, during the course of him going down the river, his big sister was kind of watching out for him. Where was his baby going to go along the river? And of all places, Pharaoh's daughter sees his basket, brings it to shore, looks at it, sees his baby, and just falls in love with his baby. But she knows this is a Jewish baby. She knows why this baby has been put in the river to try to save him, to try to keep him away from being killed. But she falls in love with this baby and wants to take Moses to be her own. So shortcutting a lot of things in the story, Moses grew up like an Egyptian. He grew up as like a prince in Egypt. A baby that should have been killed is growing up in the culture and the customs and the luxuries of Egypt.
Yes.
He's not doing the hard labor that he sees all of his brothers, sisters, cousins doing. He's walking around and he's seeing this opportunity. He sees like one of the Jewish people getting abused by an Egyptian and he actually kills him. The Egyptian. And he runs away to Midian, where he marries a woman, he has a family, and he was a shepherd. Now that's a pretty extensive, unique set of experiences in preparation for Moses to hit the turning point in his life in Exodus 3, verses 1-4, where it says, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. That Moses saw that although the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I'll go over and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up? When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. That's a story that we all go to when we think of Moses. But I think the important thing is to understand that Moses, from childhood all the way up, had these unique experiences and this unique understanding and encounter with God that gave him potential. In a special way that no one else would have. But just like Moses, our potential comes in who God designed us to be.
Yeah.
I mean, Pastor Dale talked about Jeremiah 1:5, where Jeremiah had that potential from before he was born. Ephesians 2:10 says this, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now, handiwork is not my favorite version of translation of that word. I mean, the King James Version uses the word workmanship. God doing work on us, creating us specially.
Yes.
But my absolute favorite translation of that word is actually in the New Living Translation, where it says, we're God's masterpiece.
Amen.
Do you think of yourself as a masterpiece?
Thank you, God.
And that's not because of what we do.
No.
Or what we earn or acquire. That's because from the start, God designed us as his masterpiece. You see how each of us, if you look around, are the same in the fact that we're all human beings, but we're also different. Tall, short, wide, narrow. All the different dimensions of us. Some of us have more hair, less hair, gray hair, all the different ways. Some of us are younger and older. Some of us sing better. Pastor Dale said I could get up and sing after the next day. She's like, oh, wait, no, that was preach. And while I was in Ellsworth Jackson's choir, she was Ellsworth Jackson's soloist. We all have different gifts and abilities to make use of. There's no better place that I can see this every day that I get to watch sports. Any sports fans here? Anybody in mourning that football season is ending? I really don't know what to do this afternoon. I will be going through withdrawal. But in a sport like football, where you look at the uniqueness of each of the different players and the positions, and not to be an expert in football, but you know that there's some really big 300-pound dudes that are really strong, right? And those people are linemen that either are pushing or tackling, oversimplifying it. There's some really fast folks that are just streaking down the field and going to catch a touchdown. Their speed, their hands, and their ability to catch. And of course, you know, there's the quarterback that we all hear about who's ready to go back for a pass and throw that ball. The skill to survey the field and to know the play and the options and what all the people are in the field are going to do and to time it with accuracy to throw that pass is something we marvel at. But now it's basketball season, so we're talking about the tall folks, right? The real tall folks. Yeah, there's a guard here and there that might be a little shorter. But those different skills to play basketball versus football, or coming up this spring with baseball, or we just saw the World Cup and all the countries in the world playing soccer. I never really got into playing with my feet to use a ball. When I play soccer, I want to be goalie because then I can go back to using my hands. But, you know, that's just an example of how we use different things that God created us to be. Amen. And something just so simple as sports. And as I look at this place, we have this commonality and this desire to come together and worship the Jesus. But we have different gifts and experiences that God has given or allowed us to have, but it feeds into our unique purpose. Think about your gifts. Think about your experiences. The combination puts you in places to do things and to reach people that, honestly, I probably would never even meet some of the people that you meet. And vice versa. Think in your life. Think of all the things that you know you're good at. The things that you're very confident you can do. It could be in your career or in your home or just in terms of how you interact with people. Think of the things, though, that maybe you kind of wish never happened. Think of the things that if you could just kind of erase it from, you know, whatever year in the past, you would probably do that. But God can use that as well. God can use that as a part of the potential you have to fulfill your purpose that God's designed for you. God has developed that. So the first way we're positioned for more is from our potential from God. Yeah. The second way we're positioned for more is in the possibilities from God. You know, God had been there and had been watching over Moses from before he was born. And we come to that point of transition with that burning bush thing that everybody likes to like draw pictures of and try to visualize how that could possibly be. But the key thing about that experience, that unique experience that Moses had, was a new possibility. Exodus 3:9-10 says, "And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me," referring to God. God had heard these Israelites who were in slavery and oppression in Egypt. And God says, "I've seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." Okay, what kind of possibilities is God putting to Moses here? I mean, he's just left Egypt. He is tending sheep. Okay, I mean, maybe it's not the job everybody wants to do, but he's got a job, he's got a family. And he seems to be doing all right. I mean, yeah, he's lived in Egypt. He knows Egypt. He remembers people that are still back there and still alive. But he's not looking to go back. Remember, he actually killed somebody back there. They might remember that. But this shepherd was going to be turned into a leader of Israel. And not just a leader, the Bible refers to Moses as one of the greatest leaders of Israel. Really? Moses? But I think of New Testament scriptures like the one we read in Ephesians 3:20. "Now to him who was able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine according to his power that is at work within us." Because while Moses had potential and had been set up in position for what he could do according to God's design, it was God that was going to work in him.
Yep.
And use him in the possible ways that he was just starting to show Moses.
Mm-hmm.
What about for you today? Sometimes I think we get in a routine and a rut, and we just don't necessarily think about it unless something shifts us out of that routine. Some of the possibilities and things that God wants us to do might really blow our minds if we really knew.
Yes.
But some of those possibilities just kind of come along as we're going day by day. It could be something as simple as saying hello to someone. Because you don't know what they need to hear and how they need to know that they're acknowledged and seen by somebody. Sometimes it could be praying for a coworker who's going through something in their families, in their health, or whatever the situation might be. Sometimes it might be offering some help to a neighbor who's trying to do something in the yard or trying to shovel some snow, which I'm hoping we won't get too much more of. And sometimes it might be sharing what Jesus has done in your life.
Amen.
So that they can see the example.
Amen.
And what they need in their lives.
Amen.
We just need to be open and we need to be ready.
Yeah.
Just like with Moses, God shows us new possibilities for life. With the God-given potential and with the possibilities from God, we come to a third way that we're positioned for more. And that's in the performance by us with God. Now, performance wasn't my first choice of a word, but I was on a roll with P's starting each of the words, so I went to the thesaurus and went with potential possibilities in performance, just to try to make it more memorable. But this performance I'm talking about is not achievement-oriented, but it is action-oriented. It's about what we do about it, whatever the it is that God prompts us to do. Now, Moses is an interesting example here. What did Moses do when he was prompted with the possibilities? What was his performance? His actions that he took were to like start spouting off doubts and excuses. Okay, well, in Exodus 3, Moses is like, well, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? I mean, that's a good question. I mean, he's a shepherd, come on. Well, God's response in the next verse, I'll be with you.
All right. Amen.
Now, some of us might have stopped there and be like, okay, well, God's got me on that one. Well, no, not Moses. Moses then proceeds to say, who do I represent?
Yeah.
What's his name? What's the name of who I represent? And God says, I am who I am.
Okay.
Well, Moses, you start to wonder about him. Well, in Exodus 4, he gets used, but what if they don't believe me or want to listen to me? Okay. Well, so God's starting to give a different approach. I've talked to Moses. Now we're going to show Moses a few things. So God gives him signs of things that he can do with the staff in his hand and turning water into blood and different things so that he has more confidence in who he's talking to and what it means that God will be with him. Well, apparently that was not enough. Because Moses says in verse 10 of chapter 4, pardon your servant, Lord. I love the properness of the tone in the translation, which they preserve. Pardon your servant, Lord. I mean, that's not how we talk today, but as proper as that sounds, he goes on to say, I'm not eloquent. Really? Pardon your servant, Lord? And then he wants to talk about, I'm slow of speech and tongue. Okay. So God's got another answer for him. Who gave human beings their tongues?
All right.
Amen.
Who made them deaf or mute? Who gives them sight or makes them blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will help you speak, and you will teach, and will teach you what to say. Okay. Can you picture Moses being like, great, what else can I come up with at this point? So finally, Exodus 4:13, Moses, again, pardon your servant, Lord. Please send someone else, please. Okay, now we're down to it. Moses just doesn't want to go. And so, in Exodus 4:14-15, then the Lord's anger burned against Moses, and he said, okay, what about your brother, Aaron, the Levite? I know he can speak well. He's already on the way to meet you, and he will be glad to see you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. Okay? I think God is kind of down to his bottom line with this too. So in Exodus 4:20, so Moses took his wife and sons, put them on a donkey, and started back to Egypt. But he took the staff of God in his hand and ultimately, finally conceded to just do it despite his doubts. Now, we sit here, we look at this story, and we're just like, really, Moses? Couldn't you wise up after like two or three of these kind of pushbacks on God? Is that really what you should be doing? Pushing back on what God is asking you to do. And then some of us cower back a little bit and be like, yeah, I've kind of done that a little bit myself. Not being sure when God prompts me. Performance, according to God's instruction, requires us to move past our doubts. To follow God's directions. In the big things, or in the small things. Because when we start getting the whole attitude of, yeah, but God, all the excuses start kicking in. The excuses about maybe us not realizing our potential, not seeing the possibilities of what God wants to do through us. Because we're just focused on what we see and what we not know and not who's going with us.
Amen.
God just wants us to follow and to do whatever he instructs.
Yes.
Just do it.
Amen.
For the last 2 weeks, in my mind, the phrase that's been going through my head is, there's more. There's more. And that can apply to so many different aspects of our lives. But looking at Moses' story shows how God can work in our stories with the potential and the possibilities if we're willing to perform with God alongside. God has immeasurably more for us.
Amen.
If we can just go after him. If you watch the news today being, you know, over the last week or so, there's just so much going on in our world. I mean, we see violence and shootings in our communities, in our schools. There's an earthquake that I see updates from a missionary that I'm friends on Facebook with. The death count is up to 40,000 people from the earthquake. There's wars that kind of resurface or pop up in different areas of the world. I mean, we talked about Ukraine, but there's other wars going on elsewhere. And I'm about to just get off of social media for all the hatefulness that goes between people and groups. And there's so many other things going on, whether it be out in the news or whether it just be things that we're dealing with in our own lives. And with some of the other things that I've been involved in and getting frustrated with, all the different issues, this phrase keeps coming back to me.
Yes.
There's more. As a God prompter in my mind, there's more. And so, earlier this week, I was toying with, you know, what to do, wanting to maybe get away, you know, have a break from some of the chaos and nonsense that I've been dealing with. And I started to watch some friends post on social media about some things going on. So on Wednesday morning, I got up, checked online to see what was going on, and I decided to drive to Kentucky. Okay? No, I don't have family in Kentucky. I do have a couple friends, which I didn't realize where they lived in the state. But some of the things you're not seeing on the news, or at least not as much, by intention, I do believe, is that that Asbury University in Wilmore, Kentucky, I've never been there, there was a chapel meeting on February 8th. On February 8th, some students stayed after, you know, like students on a Christian college, this is a Christian college, have to come to chapel. So imagine a church service like multiple times during the week when you know you got to study for a test and you still got to go to church.
Yep.
As a student and an adult, I get it. I wouldn't be too thrilled either. But these students went to this chapel service and they stayed.
Yep.
They stayed after the chapel service because they were so much wanting more of God in their lives. That they stayed hours and hours and days afterwards. Now, in and out, different students probably going to class or maybe going to sleep at some point, but 24/7 for at least the first week, they were having revival services.
Amen.
And I don't mean revival services in the sense that we normally used to think of it, for some of us that are old and have some gray, we're bringing a special preacher to advertise it, and those were awesome things. But this is a service where we've got young adults crying out to God. Young adults praying, young adults singing, young adults confessing sin that's going on in their lives. Because they just more than anything want to seek more of God.
Amen.
And that example has spread to at least 3 or 4 other campuses that are confirmed in many other places. And now has started to bring people to Kentucky. So after a week of this going on and seeing even a couple friends that had gone that are pastors in other states, I decided I'm just going to Kentucky. And I got there, and anybody that knows me is, I'm kind of one of these skeptical people. I'm going to go in there, and I'm just going to be like, just check this out. It's like, take it easy here, and let's see what's going on. And at first, I was like, in a line to even get in this auditorium of 1,500 people, because I wanted to get in the main one, because there were 2 other buildings where they had people, because they were such an overflow of people wanting to get in there. And I sat down, and I was kind of watching. It's at the transition. I had just missed the kind of testimony time that they had. And I was like, oh, man, I don't want to go out because I want to get back in the line to come back in. I'm thinking I've already driven 5.5 hours. I can't stay tomorrow. All these things going through my mind. And as people kind of transition out and other people start to file in, the musicians just kept playing. And 1,000 to 1,500 people just singing randomly. No words on screens or anything. Sometimes you knew the song, sometimes you didn't. But you just chimed in. It could be a chorus, it could be a hymn, it could be whatever it is. But you know what? It wasn't about what was playing.
Yeah.
It was about the spirit of people gathering together to seek God with such a desperation that it was just contagious. So I started to lose track of who was around me and what was going on and just commune with God. And at points in time, just breaks from that to talk to the people next to me. I remember thinking to myself, God, I don't want to leave this place, but I know how I am. I'm going to get thirsty. What am I going to do? There was a family that came in next to me. And the guy says to me, hey, they handed me this bottle of water. We already had some we brought. Do you want it? I'm like, seriously, God? Seriously. I talked to an older couple next to me, and we just, I don't know, how people God can connect in ways that you just don't understand. I honestly, I don't even remember, I don't know her name. It just didn't matter. We were just part of God's family. Occasionally talking, she's like, where are you from? I'm like, I'm from Michigan. Where are you from? She's from another part of Kentucky. And we just started talking, and she's like, did you just come down here by yourself? She also thought I was 25, but I was like, thank you. And she was amazed by that. We just struck up a conversation, and you have to understand, I've been employed for 6 months. And so for me to just want to spend the gas money to do that, that was one of those things God prompts you need to do. You need to figure it out. Like, if I get tired, I got a credit card, we'll get a hotel, or I'll sleep in the car, or I'll sleep up in the balcony at the auditorium. Figure this out. I just feel like I need to be there. I need to take the action that God prompted me to take. Because part of even just getting in the car to take off was a seeking of more of God.
Amen.
Because he kept telling me, there's more.
Yes.
There's more of me that you can experience if you get in the car and drive to Kentucky.
Praise
and do something that makes absolutely no sense.
Praise
sitting next to this lady, she leaned over me. I was going to stay a couple hours because, five and a half hours back. I'm going on a day trip here. I stayed 5 hours. And it seemed like it was just moments. And I just didn't want to leave because I was basking in the presence of God so profoundly. The lady next to me, she connected with me. And I saw her. And I saw her, and she was singing in the last couple songs, and she leaned over me and said, well, we're going to be leaving pretty soon in another song or two, but it's been great meeting you. You know, and I'm watching her, and she's standing and raising her hands or sitting at times and praying, and we're all just different emotions at different times. And at one point, she leans over to me and says, I'm so glad I met you. And she hands me something, just hand to hand. And I opened it up afterward. I saw that she'd given me some money. I didn't look at how much. I opened it up, and this is what she gave me. And for those of you who can't see it or those that are online, it's a $100 bill.
Praise the Lord.
This was enough for my gas all the way down.
Yeah.
My gas all the way back. And my time. God wanted me to have more.
That's right.
Not more money. Money is always a good thing. God wanted me to have the experience of Him in that place with those people. Some of them that looked like me, most of them that did not. Some of them the same music I knew, some of them the same music I had no clue, but was Googling the lyrics to be like, wow, this is a good song. I want to know what they're saying.
Yeah.
That experience of God showed me that there's more.
Yeah.
There's more than each and every one of us can experience.
Yes.
God has positioned us in unique places. At different points in time, He'll be with us. But sometimes we just need to have that special experience of God and know that there's more for us. So as we prepare to pray, the question I have for you is, do you want more of God? You know, I'm an ordained pastor. I've been a Christian since I was young, and just like a lot of us, I've had those times where you might wonder, but there's always more of God, because God is that big. He is infinite. He is immeasurable, and He will be with us. So you can take this time to talk to God wherever you are. I invite you, if you want, you can come to the altar. Everything starts in a Jesus, the one that these students in Wilmore, Kentucky cry out to and confess their sins to because they know that blocks that relationship with God. And for those of us who have connected with God, to understand that we have potential from God and He wants to use us in so many ways in the places that we are. We just need to take the step.
Amen.
And act. And by what we do, so many others will be encouraged. By what a group of college kids did on a campus in Kentucky. There are people from around this country and around this world that have been encouraged. There's more of God for each and every one of us.
Yes.
Do you want to seek Him this morning?
Yes.
Take this opportunity. Bow your heads with me. And there's nothing special about this place up front. We had people kneeling in the seats where there was no room to kneel. We had people praying in their seats because their knees wouldn't take kneeling. We had people standing. We had people lifting up their hands. But I want you, just for a moment, to just tell God what you want of Him. Do you want more? I want you to ask God from all the things that you've experienced, especially those things that you wish had never happened in your life, how does He want to use you? And before your mind starts going there, because I know mine does, with all the excuses and all the doubts, just force yourself to say, "Yes, Lord, I want more of You." So I'm going to kneel at this front area because it's something I don't always do. Sometimes I feel like I can just pray and do whatever I need to do. But sometimes I think it's important for us to acknowledge in humility how great God is and humble ourselves before Him. Whether it be physically or whether it just be in our hearts and minds. Because there's so much more of God that is so much bigger than we can comprehend. So God, I thank You. I thank You for who You are. That not even about what You do for us, not even about all the things You grant us, from the air we breathe to the ability to get up this morning. But God, You are the ultimate, the supreme, the most powerful, the mighty. And there's so much about You that is so bigger than anything our minds can comprehend. And so God, I can say to You each and every day, I want more of You, and there's never a point in which You will run out of more to give. But I want more of You, not in terms of what You can do, but in terms of how You can transform me, and how You can transform each and every one of us into all
that you want us to be. And I pray that you would help us. Help us in those tough times. Help us in those times of doubt and wanting to make excuses. Help us to reach out to you and to know that what we do can help transform the lives of others. And so, God, thank you. Thank you for who you are and for what you do. And help us all.